administrative items that we need to address, so we can go right to the docket. And the first bill we have on the docket today is House Bill 214 from Delegate Sullivan. Are you okay presenting to the three of us, and then we can share our wisdom when?
I trust the three of you implicitly, absolutely.
Okay, that's.
You can vote later.
Did you record that?
The crush, absolutely.
Okay, so why don't you go ahead and present your bill?
Sure, this is a simple bill, Mr. Chairman and members of the committee. This is HB 214. This has to do with the process of collecting signatures to get on the ballot. And at the moment, people circulating petitions must be residents of the Commonwealth of Virginia for a lot of different reasons and in a lot of different places. There have been opportunities for people who might not be residents of Virginia to come help with this process now that we're, among other things, we're an important state in the presidential races. So what we've crafted here is a way to allow out-of-state people to help campaign simply gather these petitions. The question was asked, well, what do we do? People leave the state. We can't get them back. If there's an issue, you'll see on lines 23 through 29, and then I think again on lines 88 through 94, what happens is a person who might be from state Maryland or any of the other 49 states has to sign an affidavit that consents to the jurisdiction of these courts, should he or she need to be held back into Virginia. It also makes very clear that if we've all seen these petitions, if one of these petitions is witnessed by an out-of-state person and he fails to appear or produce documents, if there's some issue with any of those signatures, then they all go out. So there are a lot of protections here. This is simply to make it easier on campaigns. Delegate Rush in my neck of the woods. Sometimes we have people from Maryland who want to come over and help. Wouldn't be surprised if there might be some people from neighboring North Carolina or West Virginia definitely wants to come help us. Right? And in, certainly in the presidential context, we get people from all over the country who want to come in and help their various candidates, of course, on both sides of the aisle. So it's a simple bill. Simply makes it a little easier and broadens the number of people with lots of safeguards to make sure it is.
Thank you, Delegate Sullivan. Questions to the paper?
Yes. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. So, what's if I was an out-of-state resident who signed the affidavit and violated the provisions in the bill, was that a misdemeanor? Or
I think I'll rely on counsel, but I believe the affidavit's not going to. I think if anybody in state or if we sure pass this bill, anybody who misrepresents something on that affidavit, I believe it's just.
I guess my point would be is I go collect the signatures and find out something's wrong with them. You say I'm subject to a Virginia court because I've signed an affidavit saying mm-hmm. What's the likelihood of me being extradited from Nevada for a misdemeanor here in Virginia? I'm not sure what kind of weight that would have on.
And Delegate Sullivan, I believe the answer to the question is not that it's putting on a penalty for not signing or for not coming on the person who is not responding to the affidavit.
Yeah.
It's a penalty that on the campaign and what is meant to incentivize a person to actually sign the affidavit and then respond is that if you come from Nevada to help a person campaign and collect signatures, you would want to make sure that you aren't doing something that would jeopardize the validity of those signatures.
But if the validity of the signatures were turned in at the very last moment, they weren't, and that could be, you'd have to go to court much later on.
And then they wouldn't, if there was a question like, are these signatures really real people? I mean, we've had some issues recently.
A lot of them, yeah.
Then would that get to the court if the person who collected the signatures doesn't come to court to help answer those questions, then the signatures just aren't counted.
All right, great.
Thank you.
Madam Chair, Mr. Chair,
yes.
Excuse me. Online, Delegate Rush, further answer in line 26 to 29, we'll see. It creates a very bright line rule. So
yeah, so.
It doesn't, if you don't show up, the whole thing gets thrown out. So the incentive, frankly, is on the campaign to get to your show.
Yeah. And this is something courts have, this was, I believe, if I remember correctly from our conversations, this was really coming from a court case that said our requirement that you be a legal resident of the Commonwealth wasn't constitutional. But other states that had this type of provision, that this is a very valid way to
okay.
Right.
Try to keep
thank,
thank,
thank you for reminding me. Yes, there was some litigation there. Surprise there, litigation over elections.
Delegate Rasul, did you have any other questions?
No, No, I think council clarified.
Does anyone else have any questions? Is there anyone in the audience who would like to speak in favor of the bill? Is there anyone who would like to speak in opposition to the bill? Yes, ma'am.
Mr. Chairman, Clyde Wheeler, Albemarle County, former electoral board, election officer, et cetera. I've passed a lot of signature petitions, and as a proud Virginian, I think if a candidate wants his or her name on a ballot in a Virginia election, whether it's presidential primary or supervisors, I think you ought to be a Virginian. I mean, if you care about Virginia elections, then you ought to be a Virginian. If a candidate wants to be on a Virginia ballot, getting enough people to pass petitions, I don't think is an onerous task, even with the number of signatures for a presidential primary. You ought to be able to get enough Virginians to do that job. And finding people who have left the state or the Commonwealth after getting these petitions signed would be very difficult.
All right.
I think this should be a Virginia.
Okay. Thank you very much. Is there anyone else who would like to speak in opposition to the bill? Delegate Sullivan, you have the last word.
Just the last 12 seconds is, again, sort of reprising what council said. There is a case law that says, while I agree with the witness, it's nice to get as many Virginians as possible. There's a case law that says we can't limit it just to Virginians.
Okay.
And this is a way of allowing people from outside Virginia to make sure it doesn't come up the works. And we don't have troubles afterwards if they don't show up.
Okay. Thank you.
Report.
Motion to report, second. This is a recorded vote, so please record your vote on the electronic board. Okay, Delegate Sullivan, your bill reports to the full committee by vote of 3-1.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, members of the committee.
Thank you very much. We're waiting on Delegate Watts.
She's on her way.
She's on her way. Okay, so we'll be at ease while we wait for the last patron. Yes, you are. We need to have four. Where do you need to go?
I'm right upstairs, so just text me.
Okay. Fair enough.
Like Chris comes, we'll be okay.
Yeah.
I mean, it's Vivian's 60th anniversary.
He's in the
committee.
I'm supposed to be in. Is he coming here?
Yes.
Very present.
Did she have married when she was 60? I mean, did she have married when she was 1?
Not other jokes.
No, I got married while, like, I'm in the middle of my time here.
Yeah, that's what I was saying, but since I've been here, I've been
gone. No, you were here before I started.
When did you first start with the real, like, alt when I go up there?
Oh, my first session was 2014. Yeah, I got married in 2016. Yeah.
3 years to change.
Yes. Right before the last.
Yeah.
Some other reasons. Yeah. One of our constituents from Roanoke was part of our You Write the Bill program. You know about that, where we help draft legislation? Her bill's up today, so.
Okay.
Oh, yeah. So if you need something, that would be a good reason.
I'll stay.
I'm sorry.
Yeah, she's going to pass out the
system.
I'm here.
We had some good looks at it, so.
I'm fine.
We were just talking to Brigadier Delegate Rush, said that he was going to support the bill.
I'll take any.
I said I support your 60.
Oh, is that what it was?
Very supportive.
I'm very happy.
You just, you know, when you're tired, all those chats.
That you got married when you were 60, and I was like, oh,
thank you.
That's still says.
It's an awkward thing to me here in the past, I had this conversation with Cecil, who we're only a few about 6 months apart. But he's been powerful and all that, so he can say, you know, love those a lot and all that, and I have to sort of say, all I can do, Dick, is just try to be relevant and hope that they don't notice you. Thank you. No, they're getting it for me.
And what time will the service be?
No, so you have the two options, you're going to go back, so, and then you add it.
Let's see what I can do for the speaker, and to get that. I have a committee. Actually, I have a committee meeting.
So if you want to.
The chairman only had these two bills, but on this, Chairman Lindsay. Yeah. Yeah, it wasn't ever docketed. I mean, we pushed the docket out. I'm sorry, I mean, that, where did you drive 4 hours from?
Just call that, so they don't turn it away.
Oh, of course. Okay.
My de facto representative.
Okay.
But I'm here for a different bill. It's not sponsored by either one of us.
I'm sorry, but the other two that we have.
Of Bill, or whatever it was, but people were getting them and saying, who's Bill? And that's a pretty common name, and they were thinking that perhaps it was John Bill running up in Loudoun, etc. So, and I looked on the internet all up one side and down the other, and I couldn't find that as a something that someone could turn to. And so just saying that you must have your name on any of these ads on the authority line is not adequate. And so this is where I'm saying your name as it appears on the bill. And that is a frozen thing, and with the help of the AG's office, a very important part of the substitute is on line 22, where we're changing may to shall, and say when you file your statement of qualification, you shall indicate what your, how you want your name to appear on the ballot. So from the primary selection all the way through, that then is the name that would appear on the authority lines. And that gives the clarity and the transparency for people to see who's putting out this material. And I know, actually, I've always done it. I've never said Watts for delegate. I've always said Vivian Watts. But this then says that's what everyone will do, so that we know that it is, and I'll just use, can't think of a good name. We'll just say Robert Bell. But in this case, we don't need to. I'm standing here. We don't need to. But it was a mess. There were a number of calls of who is Bell, and no one could find out who Bell was. And it's something that you can come up with in all kinds of iterations. So this gives clarity to our situation.
Question, Delegate Simon?
Mr. Chair, I agree. I'm a little concerned that there's even confusion when it says friends of Robert Bell, because then who are these friends, and would this bill stop people from using vague terms like that?
Well, the way in which you see, I'm going to go to lines 30 and 31 is a good example. Paid for by, and that's the name of the candidate as it appears on the ballot, or campaign committee as it appears on the statement of organization. So you can't come up with Bell's buddies and so on as you go through the campaign.
So, Delegate Watts, so then in one instance, I think what I see that you're doing is that it's traceable back to the name on the ballot, the actual proper name, and the other one should be traceable back to a statement of organization.
And it freezes it at that point in time, so that if you were then in June looking something up, you would see how it's already on the internet as it was recorded in March or in September or whatever. It always has that trace back so that you know who it is.
And I do have another question. So if it's friends of Bell, you could, I mean, because you could end up then going back and actually, it could be multiple because it's a common name, but then you would narrow it down to something.
You've got it. And
okay.
That's it. If you were to put it on the internet, you would come up with a hit, which you wouldn't if you keep on changing the name as you go along.
Are there other questions for the patron? Yes.
So my campaign committee's friends of Nick Rush. I'm not sure I have any, but we did name it that. So I put at the bottom, pay for my friends of Nick Rush.
Mm-hmm.
That's still allowed.
Mm-hmm, absolutely.
So my name on the ballot is Larry N. Nick Rush.
And there's always been an or. So your authority line today could be either authority line. On some pieces you might want to use one, on others you might use the other.
Okay. So, but in the text of it, I don't put, hey, Larry N. Nick Rush is a great guy. I should put Nick Rush is.
I'm only talking about
friends.
The authority line.
Yeah,
it can be as fine print as.
Well, that's going to be addressed.
This was very fine print, but anyway.
Okay, because
this committee has anything to do with it.
That's just in the paper. Are there other questions for Delegate Watts? Okay. Is there anyone here in the audience who would like to speak in favor of the bill? Is there anyone who would like to speak in opposition to the bill? Yes.
I'm Clara Wheeler, Albemarle County. I have a question. It's not
yes.
For or yes. As someone who has a barn full of signs that will get used again, some will never get used again. But suppose I had a Bell sign and it didn't have a first name on it. Is there a part of this bill that would prevent you from reusing old signs? Or
no.
Would you have to put a sticker on it?
What I would suggest, and I certainly went through that for a number of years, was that if the permitting by our county changed, so we always had these stickies that we just put on the old signs so that it was the up-to-date permit. And so if you're distributing signs as a candidate, you really should, and it would be very easy to do, to put a sticky that has the proper authority line for this campaign. I can't believe that anybody's going to go back to somebody who saved your sign and put it out 2 years later. I don't.
We didn't.
Okay, well, fine, just put a little sticker on it then, distribute the sticker, thank you for putting the sign out.
Okay, go ahead.
Is there a way, I believe, Doug at Wiltsville dealt with,
Font size.
With the font size on signs, and we were concerned that with this exact, scenario, we delayed implementing that, we carried that bill over the next year. But, could, sort of delayed enactment calls, or is there a way we could put in here any sign bought after the date of this legislation, so you would?
I mean, you can certainly do an enactment clause that would specify that this only applies to signs, you know, paid for, distributed after a certain date. I think it's just a question of enforcement, like how do you know when it should apply?
All printed material and so.
And, but also, that enforcement, Mr. Chairman, that enforcement mechanism also would be in the reverse. So with the, you know, I have several people say, hey, Nick, you know, I see you putting your signs out, I got it out of my garage, I got it back up.
Andrew, go ahead, Doug, sign.
I think that worrying about the disclosure on signs is kind of irrelevant right now, because most of us already use the basic disclosure, and there's no problem with that. It's just, we have a problem with Bell. And Bell might have to redo signs, and that probably would be, you know, a good thing.
But I would take it as a friendly amendment to have a enactment clause that grandfathered all printed material and signs before the date of effective of the bill.
Mr. Chair.
Yes, go ahead, Doug.
So I would so move such amendment with a grandfathering of all printed material signs.
And what day? For what day?
I think we should go to January 1, 2021 and not fiddle with this year.
That's a good point.
And in that way, we're
that something you can write up? Okay, so we're going to accept that as a motion. Is there a second? There's a second. All those in favor of the amendment indicate by saying aye.
Aye.
All those opposed? Okay, so we're going to add an enactment clause that grandfathers in all signs and printed material that is in existence, and this would take effect on January 1st, 2021.
I would move House Bill 1556.
As amended.
As amended. The substitute as amended.
To report.
To report it.
Okay, so there's a motion to report the substitute with amendments. There's a second. Please record your votes on the electronic voting board. Watch your bill substitute as amendment passes 4-0. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
That's all. I mean, I'm going to probably see. We're done. We're done.
Thank you. Thanks for your patience to be here on this bill.
Thank you.
The substitute.
Would you and because no, it was you and Mark and Chris who were concerned about Tony Wilson. Should we do this for them?
How much cost?
And then if you
Thank you.